Calvary Bible Baptist Church. We're glad that you're watching today on
DVD. We're going to, in a moment, go to the book of Revelations. We're doing a verse-by-verse study of the book of Revelations. Today is Palm Sunday, and tonight we'll be teaching out of the book of John, and we'll be looking at Palm Sunday. We'll be looking at Passover. We'll be looking at the Bible, and we'll learn the truth. As I was telling members of the church earlier today, people don't have a clue about what the Bible teaches and what is real and what is true versus the traditions that have come into the church and the corruption and the changing of the truth of God's word and the confusion. We'll be teaching the truth tonight, but we're dealing with a commitment to teach Revelations through verse by verse. We're going to go right through these holidays are considered major holidays, being faithful to teaching God's word until what we taught people we were going to be teaching on. And in the evening service, I'll address Easter and Passover, the difference, teach the truth. If you want to know these things, come to church. Come not only to the Sunday morning service, but come to the evening service. I have a book called The Bible. It takes over 90 hours just to read it through the New Testament. It takes a long time to teach all the truth in the Bible. We have three services, and what we're doing, we're not wasting time. We're teaching God's word and God's truth. So if you would, Revelation 6:1. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard as it were the noise of thunder, and one of the four beasts saying, "Come and see." Let's open a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege to be Christians. Father, we thank you for your goodness, and we thank you for your truth. Father, we pray now that people here would come to see, know, and understand your word, and that you'd open the truth of it to them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, we just had these recent airstrikes on Syria, and it was dramatic, and the internet, of course, as always, is speculating many things about end time prophecies off of these current events, and they're always wrong because they're always going with the flesh, they're always going with sensationalism, they're always getting excited about that which is just everyday life. And I know it was a major event, and we're probably gonna have another one very soon with North Korea, but there are nothing more than wars and rumors of wars that have been going on for centuries. That's all you're dealing with. You're not dealing with anything in these issues that have to do with the end of the age and the great tribulation. Jesus told the truth. He said, "And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet." And so man has been fighting wars for thousands of years, because man is not a lover of God, a lover of truth, and a lover of his fellow man. The love of many is waxing cold in this age, and people don't have the slightest clue to what love is. Love is always giving to the benefit of another to help them in godliness. Lust is always taking from another for selfish gratification and benefits. It's real simple. It's amazing how simple it is and how so few people have no idea what real love is and what real lust is. Lust is destroying, love healing and mending. And though people talk about it, they don't have it. It is not in man to direct his steps. Man is just hurting man all too often. And the truth shall make you free. So what you're seeing in Syria, though it's close to where the end of the age will end, it's just wars and rumors of wars. And what you're going to see in North Korea, it's wars and rumors of wars. We had World War II, World War I, we had the Korean War, we have the Vietnam War, we had the Asian. Man has a propensity for wars. However, there is a very important prophetic news event that was completely missed with the drama of current events. Despite talk of moving American embassy in Israel to Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, no nation in the world recognizes the holy city as Israel's capital city until now. And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it should be cut in pieces, though all the people of the earth be gathered together against it. What happened on Thursday last before the missile strikes was something that was quite astounding, moving us to the end of the age and the great tribulation in our lifetime. The Jerusalem Post reports that a surprising move, Russia now says that West Jerusalem is the capital of the Jewish state. I bring your attention to God's position dealing with his people. By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required of us a song, and they that wasted us required of us myrrh, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Now this goes back to the first captivity when Nebuchadnezzar comes in and carries the Jews away captive. This was a punishment by God on the Jewish nation for their infidelity to him and their corruption and their refusal to be the holy people that he called them to be. God's law taught them not to lie, not to steal, not to adulter, not to fornicate, to show respect and reverence towards him. They were just like Americans are today, and God took them away. That's the easiest way to say it. No respect for elders, no discipline, no care for anybody else but themselves. Selfish, self-centered. That's the way Americans are today. Greedy, lazy. They want everybody else to pay for them rather than for them to earn and pay for themselves. That's not every American. That's a lot of Americans. We have left the godliness that America once knew, where people were responsible for themselves, took care of themselves, and helped their neighbors that were in need, not helping the neighbors of greed. There's a distinction, very easy to see. If your friend, your neighbor is in need, then we have an obligation to help. If they're lazy, it will not work, they ought not to eat. The Bible's very clear. And boy, do the lazy ones try to make themselves needful ones. How should we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? It's very difficult. Now, that's what I'm doing today. I'm preaching God's words, God's truth. We're singing God's song. This is not the America that I once knew. It's a strange land. If I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget her cunning. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. Man is supposed to love God. That's the first commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy mind, with all thy strength. The Jewish people were to worship and love their God. Jerusalem was their capital. The Jerusalem Post reports that in a surprising move, Russia now says that West Jerusalem is the capital of the Jewish state. Russia now recognizes West Jerusalem as Israel's capital. The Russian Foreign Ministry stated in a surprise announcement on Thursday, obtained exclusively by the Jerusalem Post. Now the scriptures, because of thy temple at Jerusalem, shall kings bring presents unto thee. The Jewish people have it in their heart to rebuild their temple and restore temple worship. They asked Putin, they asked Trump, the Sanhedrin, a official letters to recognize Israel's right to live in the land and to rebuild the temple. Their prayers and hopes are that these men, since they're two of the world leaders, would support Israel in the rebuilding of her temple. And they're looking for these men to be like Cyrus, ancient king, that made the decree for the Jews to return to their homeland and rebuild the temple after their chastisement of the Lord. The announcement comes as U.S. President Donald Trump's administration is agonizing over whether to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, a move that would constitute recognizing West Jerusalem as the country's capital. No other country in the world yet recognizes any part of Jerusalem as Israel's capital. Therefore, now we'll go back to the ancient prophecies. Prophesy thou against them all these words and say unto them, the Lord shall roar from on high and utter his voice from his holy habitation. He shall mightily roar upon his habitation. He shall give a shout as they that tread the grapes against the inhabitants of the earth. A noise shall come even to the ends of the earth, for the Lord hath a controversy with the nations. He will plead with all flesh. He will give them that are wicked to the sword, saith the Lord. Now, how that leaves us as a nation, I don't think we're going to end up well. Because America used to be a very godly nation, is now an extremely wicked nation. And God judges on godliness. Now, at present, though, I do expect that Donald Trump will move the American embassy to Jerusalem, and there will be strong support for Israel. That is a good thing. But that one good deed does not undo millions of wrongdoing deeds. Although it's always right to do right, and it's never right to do wrong. That's so simple, but people have a hard time with it these days, don't they? Oh, what tangled webs we weave when at first we begin to deceive. The statement issued by the Russian Foreign Ministry reads, we reaffirm our commitment to the UN-approved principles for a Palestinian-Israeli settlement, which includes the states of East Jerusalem as the capital of a future Palestinian state. And at the same time, we must state that in this context, we view West Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. So they're going to be pushing for the two-state solution. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathered together the outcasts of Israel. Now, we know we're in the last days. We know we're in, and we've gone through it, and we know we can't set the day or the hour. No man knows this, but we know we're 50 years or less. We know it's very close to the Great Tribulation. We know this because after thousands of years, the prophecies of Israel returning to the land and being reestablished as a state have been fulfilled, and the Jews returned. A miracle occurred in 1948, and time is moving towards God's destiny for the world. Israel has not had a single state recognize Jerusalem as her capital, though Jerusalem is, always has been, the capital of Israel. Now you need to understand, I don't have time to get into it today. We'll teach more details as we move through the book of Revelation. The Palestinians have absolutely no claim to any of the land of Israel. That's a false flag. There were no Palestinians until just recent times. There was nomads that roamed through the land of Israel. Israel is the Jewish people, ancient homeland. They were cast out by God, they were brought back, and then when they rejected their Messiah and were responsible for his crucifixion, along with the Roman government representing the world, they were cast out again and dispersed for 2,000 years. This is their punishment for their rejection of their God and their Savior, and now they're being brought back to be restored. Their Savior is getting ready to come back, who, by the way, is our Savior, and establish his throne to rule the world from Israel. And what we've been teaching is Revelation is where the Spirit and the flesh come together, where God, who is a spirit, comes to the earth and dwells with men who are flesh and blood in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a sharp shift in Russian policy, which until now has formally held that Jerusalem should eventually be under a permanent international regime. Israel, and that's the position many countries have taken, and Russia, were at odds because Russia held a position that should be under international regime. But now they are going to stand behind a two-state solution. Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, that he made a proclamation through all his kingdom, and put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judea. This was the first dispersion of which Cyrus made a decree for the Jew to go back and rebuild the temple. Okay, we're now looking at the third temple. Thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord God of heaven hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judea. Who is there among you of all his people? His God be with him, and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and build the house of the Lord God of Israel. He is the God which is in Jerusalem. And the world is going to meet its creator, the living God, very soon now. And a lot of people are going to be astonished and shocked. Now, the statement appears in English on the Russian Foreign Ministry's Russian website. It should not be long before the Trump administration does the same thing, so that in the process of time, there will be a false peace between Israel and the Palestinians, leading to fulfillment of what we now study. Now, these things that are about to happen are already prophesied in the Bible. They're going to fulfill Scripture. Let me bring your attention to Isaiah. Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people, which is in Israel. Now, here's the hard thing to learn and understand. And we say it as Christians, but for the grace of God, there go I. You need to realize and understand that things aren't always just shifted one way. And what I mean by that is this. Israel is returned to the land in unbelief. Israel has turned in the returned to the land in rebellion to her God. She's not right with her God. She is going to be passed under the rod. That's what the tribulation is all about. Israel is responsible for her Messiah being crucified, as well as all sins of all people are responsible for Christ being crucified. However, to be anti-Semitic is the position of the devil, and it's wicked. You are to see Israel as God sees you, a sinner that needs to be redeemed and that needs grace and mercy, and is offering it until the patience of the long-suffering God runs out. And what I mean by all that is, don't ever become anti-Semitic. I strongly support Israel's right to the land. God gave it to her. It's God's land, and he gave it to Israel. They belong there. I realize they're not right with God yet, but then look at God's people, the church, how far they've moved away from God. And if it wasn't for God's grace, the church would also be destroyed. Where the truth of it is, the true remnant of the church will be taken off the earth before God pours his wrath out on an unbelieving world. So here we go. Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people which is in Jerusalem. That's what God sees in the Israeli government right now. Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with hell we're in agreement. They are going to make a covenant with the Antichrist. We're going to see that as we study death and hell following the white horse rider. With the overflowing scourge shall pass through, it shall not come on to us. They believe that by making this covenant with the Antichrist, it's going to allow them to rebuild their temple. They're going to avoid their judgment. For we have, and they've done this by making lies our refuge. And under falsehood, we have hid ourselves. Now, this is something I've been teaching the church. This is the lack of truth and falsehood. The distinguishing, the discerning between being nice and being godly. You go to the car salesman. He treats you real nice. He sells you a lemon. That's not godly. Being godly is treating people kindly and affectionately, truthfully and honestly, without hurting them. Our culture and world is filled up with so many wicked people that know how to act nice so they can slice your throat while smiling. That's ungodly. That's wicked. They don't know how to be truthful and loving and kind. And that's what people need to learn. You need to see Israel and her sins and be truthful about it and see them as God sees them, but you need to be loving and kind to them in their sins, not allowing their sins. We'll follow that later. They made lies our refuge, under falsehood we hid ourselves. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion a foundation stone, a tried stone, a precious cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. This is Christ. Judgment also will I lay to the lion, and righteousness to the plummet, and the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the water shall overflow the hiding place. And your covenant with death shall be disannulled, and your agreement with hell shall not stand when the overflowing scourge shall pass through. Israel is going to be destroyed nationally during the tribulation. Then ye shall be trodden down by it. They will be reduced, a nation of about 15 million people reduced to about 150,000 souls during the tribulation, as two-thirds of the earth will be destroyed in this tribulation. When Israel has a recognized capital, then it will be possible to make a peace agreement with the Palestinians, allow the Jews to rebuild their temple. The Arab nations are now ready for peace. It is just the Palestinians that need to agree to it. You talk with Jordan and the Saudis and the Egyptians. After years of hatred and war, they're tired of it. And they really want to make peace with Israel. That's why you have these two factions, the Sunnis and the Shias. And that's why you see Islam split into the two factions. And the one faction, Saudi Arabia, Jordan, Egypt, these are countries that warred against Israel, now are ready to make peace with Israel. You got the Palestinian group, Hamas, and some of the others. They're still fighting for their own state. They want a statehood. And you're going to see a forced agreement or statehood, a two-state solution, coming very soon after Israel's capital is recognized and the rest of the Arab contingency compel the Palestinians to make a peace agreement. And they will make one with lies. They'll be nice, and they will break that peace agreement. From the time that it goeth forth, it shall take you. By morning shall it pass over. By day, By night, it should be a vexation only to understand a report. For the bed is shorter than a man can stretch himself on it, and the covering narrower than he can wrap himself in it. For the Lord shall raise up as in Mount Pezerim, he shall be wroth as in the valley of Gibeon, that he may do his work, his strange work, to bring to pass his act, his strange act. Now therefore, be ye not mockers, lest your bands be made strong. For I have heard from the Lord of hosts a consumption even determined upon the whole earth. Tribulation, as I said earlier, and we'll see this as we go through the book of Revelations, this will be a death time in 7 years to about two-thirds of the population of the earth. So we're moving up on 8 billion people. You can expect to see 2 billion people left after the seven-year period of time, roughly. You can expect to see Israel reduced from 15 million to a few hundred thousand. Israel is now ready to trade land for peace because they want peace. But God is not, never will be. He has an eternal covenant with Israel. The covenant was long before Palestinian people ever existed. The land, this is the law. At this time there was no Palestinians. The land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine, for ye are strangers and sojourners with me. God told the people of Israel they were never to sell the land. When the Palestinians finally recognize West Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, they will divide the land of Israel to gain peace. That's prophesied. That's what's coming up. Thus shall he do in the most strongholds with a strange God, whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and shall divide the land for gain. They're going to gain. 3.5 years after the peace agreement is made, it will be broken, and then the great tribulation will start the last 3.5 years. And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. You have 1 week, which is a 7-year period of time in which God is going to deal with the world and Israel, before the great tribulation starts at the middle part, the last 3.5 years. And that's when, as I say, all hell's going to break loose and the death is going to be awful in the earth. In the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and oblation to cease, and for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate even until the consummation, and that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. That's Israel. She is going to suffer judgment for her infidelity and her immorality against her God, as well as the world that persecutes her. Okay, here's the lesson. Most important, be harmless as doves and wise as serpents. A Christian is not to be a person that harms and hurts other people. Whatsoever you would that men should do on you, do you so likewise unto them, for this is the law and the prophets. A Christian is to be able to know and discern and observe other people's sins and avoid them. And you can reprove and rebuke people and tell them they are going to hurt themselves. But we're not to harm people. That's what I was cautioning with Israel. It's very easy to read the Bible, God's book, written by Jewish prophets through the inspiration of the Almighty, and become anti-Semitic until you understand God's purpose for Israel and have compassion and pity on them as you wanted God to have on you. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. What Christians fail to realize today, it's supposed to be grace for grace. You repented of yourself, you trusted Christ as your Savior, and God forgave you, forgive somebody else. Now, that doesn't mean you accept or condone other people's sin. And you can reprove them. In fact, you're supposed to reprove them. Your just not supposed to hurt people. The Lord will deal with the nations over the treachery of Israel. For behold, in those days, and in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat and will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted, there it is, parted my land. You see, they part the land and then they attack Israel and scatter the Jewish people again. Only it's not God doing it, it's their doing it. And God comes to their defense. However, God will first deal with Israel's infidelity with the world. As I live, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand and with stretched out arm and with fury poured out will I rule over you. And I will bring you out from the people and gather you out of the countries wherein ye are scattered with a mighty hand. That's what we just saw happen in the last 50 years. And with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there will I plead with you face to face, like as I plead with your fathers in the wilderness in the land of Egypt. So will I plead with you, saith the Lord. Now, notice that in the land of Egypt? You know what you're going to see in the tribulation as we go through the book of Revelation? You're going to see the plagues that came on Egypt, where God pleaded with the Jewish people when he brought them out. You're going to see them come on the world again. And the world is going to get those plagues. They're going to get those plagues for their persecution of Israel. But God is going to allow the world to persecute Israel because of their infidelity to him. And I will cause you to pass under the rod. And I will bring you into the bond of the covenant. Now see, this is why God is going to, this is why you should discipline children and teach them to behave and mind themselves and to raise them up to be godly and to be honest and faithful and true. Because that's what God does with his people. I will purge out from among you the rebels and them that transgress against me. I will bring them forth out of the country where they sojourn, and they shall not enter into the land of Israel, and ye shall know that I am the Lord. When God's finished, he's going to have a godly group of Jewish people, of which he's going to set up on his throne in Jerusalem to rule the world. And we, as the church, will help as this goes through the thousand-year millennium, and then as we move out into the universe. God is going to populate the universe. God is going to replace the angels of heaven that revolted against him under the treason of Satan. After this, I looked and behold, oh, now as we proceed, the church has been translated. See, we're coming through the tribulation. In chapter 4, the church goes out. The church, the body of Jesus Christ, consisting of all born-again Christians, goes out into translation before the great tribulation, be it 3.5 or 7 years, which we should consider at the appropriate time. Now, the thing you want to, and I'll give you this, and I'll teach it more in detail. The thing you want to realize, Jacob's trouble, 7 years. Okay, now, a lot of Christians have taught that that's 7 years of tribulation. And as we get closer, a lot of us are starting to realize, wait a minute, the real tribulation is the last 3.5 years. There's a false peace. We get to see the Antichrist. Sometime after that, we leave. And the world is trying to proclaim a millennium, a time of peace. That's what Hitler was saying. He was going to bring 1,000 years peace. He thought he was God. That all these despots, they're all trying to be the one to bring in this thousand-year reign. And they're going to bring in peace by killing everybody that disagrees with them. Wonderful folks, harmers, herders, life-takers and heartbreakers, murderers. The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent taketh it by force. Okay? Now, this is what's been going on. That's why you have wars and rumors of wars. And now we're coming to the cultivation of the time of human existence to where God is going to come down and rule the earth in the person of Jesus Christ. The Spirit, God is a spirit, they that worship God must worship in spirit and truth, is going to come to this earth as a man and rule the world in righteousness. And the Lord is going to let the evil eliminate the evil. Interesting. Then he's going to set up the kingdom with a remnant and the righteous. The great tribulation is the pouring out of God's wrath. And only if we are truly born again will we go out. Now see, after this I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee the things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. So come up hither. That's what every born-again Christian is going to hear when they depart this earth without dying. If you're blessed to be alive at that time when that great event takes place. Now, the great tribulation is the pouring out of God's wrath. And if you're truly born again and you're part of the bride of Christ, you're not appointed to wrath. This is a blessing of being a Christian. Today, the world will persecute you. Today, the world will take advantage of you. Not God, but the world. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night. And they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and of love, for a helmet and hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Okay, we're not appointed unto wrath, but to salvation. The church will not be under the wrath. We go out. Now, most people have heard the term rapture. I don't use rapture because it's not a biblical word. I use a biblical word translation. In a general sense, they mean the same thing, but when you get into the etymology of words, there's some problems with the word rapture because it's got some violence and sinfulness in it that the word translation does not have. Words mean something. It's important to keep your words biblical. The Lord Jesus Christ has now stepped forward and taken the book with the seven seals and begins opening the seals to in his revelation to us. Now, this is why it's so important and why people don't really understand the Bible, because we go back to all the kooks on the internet and they see World War III and they see this Tomahawk attack and and they see all kinds of things that just aren't so. All they've been, you know, they had John Kennedy being the Antichrist. They had Obama being the Antichrist. They had Bush being the Antichrist. They had Bush the Elder being the Antichrist. They had Ronald Reagan being the Antichrist. Ronald Wilson Reagan, poor guy, had six letters in his first name, six letters in his middle name, six letters in his last name. Oh, he's got to be the Antichrist. None of that's biblical. That's just junk and confusion of depraved people trying to play God. They won't take the time to read the Bible and listen to God and get the true explanation. They miss the things in life that really happen that apply to the scriptures. They're all talking about these two big events and they're missing the big one of Russia recognizing for the first time a world power recognizing the capital of Israel. That's big. It's the Lord Jesus Christ who has the spirit of prophecy, not men. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must certainly come to pass, and he sat and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. Now, we covered this when we started. What do most people teach? It's the revelation of St. John Divine. Lie. John was just a human being like you and I. He's just a saved sinner like you and I. He just happened to have the blessing to be a disciple of the Lord. He happened to be an exemplary disciple of the Lord. That's all well and wonderful. He is not God. He does not know the mind of God. God is now revealing it to him, and he reveals it to us through his word, the same way that it was revealed to John, through God's word. The spirit of prophecy is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. When you believe the Bible and read the Bible literally and understand the Bible correctly, you'll have a spirit of prophecy that you're given by God, because God tells you things that are going to happen that you don't know and the world doesn't know is going to happen, but they do happen in God's time. But you know what Christians do and people do in their pride and their flesh? They start thinking they know the mind of God. They start telling you the day the Lord's coming back. And you know what they all do? They all get it wrong. And you know what they all do? They make fools of themselves and they hurt the body of Christ. And they get people saying, the Bible's not true. No, the nutcase that was filled with himself, he's not true. God's true. It's coming. Go read Ezekiel 37. It just took place in 1948. It was fulfilled. That's why Israel's back in the land. The Bible's true. Nuts are not true. If we stare and compare, there are many differences now. We're going to look at this white horse rider. Somehow I missed him. Let me go back here. Do I have it? Nope. There we go. And I saw, behold, a white horse. And he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. Now, a lot of folks, especially if they're post-millennial in doctrine, they'll try to tell you this is Jesus Christ. This fellow is not Jesus Christ. He does not compare with Revelation 19. In fact, post-millennialism would have us to believe the rider is the Lord Jesus Christ, and that he sprayed the kingdom, and his truth is marching on. That's where he got that song. Yeah, everybody likes the Bellhymn of the Republic. My eyes have seen the coming and the going of the Lord. That is post-millennial doctrine. That's the belief that the world's going to get better and better and better. And then when the Lord comes back, see, well, how's it going to get better and better? Oh, Union troops are going to win the war and win the Civil War, and then the world's going to become wonderful. But then we have World War I, and then we have World War II, and now we're going for World War III. And in between, we had all these other wars. Nutcases. They don't know the Bible. They're doing things out of the imagination of their mind. They're looking at human events and they're imagining things as if they were God, because they heard a little bit of truth rather than paying attention to the Bible. Does it make sense? I hope it does. Now, this rider is the devil. He wants to be a king also. So how do you know this rider is a devil? Because death and hell follow him. Okay? This guy only has one crown. On Revelation 19, the Lord Jesus Christ has many crowns. This guy has a bow. In Revelation 19, the Lord has a sword that comes out of his, a sharp two-edged sword. They're not the same individual. Now look at Revelation 19:11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. Now, you know what's the only thing that's the same with both of these riders? The white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. In righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. His name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Now this rider has the armies of heaven following him. The other rider has death and hell following him. You're going to try to tell me that the other rider, just because he has a white horse, is Jesus Christ? I don't think so. Stare and compare. Quite obvious. The guy has death and hell follow him. He's a heartbreaker and life taker. He's the devil. Here's a warning. And no marvel. Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. You know what people get deceived about? I come back to my little preaching message here. All carnal, fleshly people that want to take advantage learn to act nice, to deceive you, to think they're good when they really want to take advantage of you. You ought to have discernment. And as a Christian, you ought to learn to be genuine and true and kindly affectionate and brotherly love towards your fellow man. You see, you need to be genuine, and you ought to be able to discern their disingenuousness when they're acting nice to take advantage of you. Oh, I think you're such an intelligent, somebody as wise as you would know to buy this car, because you got so much beauty in you, it'll show so well in this car. If you only understood how capable you were and how you fit in this car, we can sell you this car for a phenomenal price, because we're going to, out of the goodness of our heart, cut the price in half to sell you this car. And then it don't work. That's the way the devil operates. He's always positive. Now, you know how a Christian would do this? Look, this car has this problem, and this problem. This car works this, this, and this. It's worth that much. I'll sell it to you for that. You want it? Take it or leave it. See, what happened then? You go out of business. In a world of wicked people. See, what would you be? Honest. Now, the truth of the matter is, you can really have a good business if you're honest with it and you labor with it. Now, you also have to be nice, because they expect that. But you ought to be nice because you're genuinely a godly person, not because you're a thief. There's only one man in the Bible that could fool some of our scholars into causing them to think the white horse rider was the Lord Jesus Christ, when there are similarities that contrast clearly to the student scriptures. I can just go over them quickly and we'll probably close. You are told the white horse rider comes out of heaven, not so in Revelation 6, death and hell follow him. Here the rider has a crown. In Revelation 19, the rider has many crowns. Here the rider has a bow. Revelation 19, a sharp sword. Here the rider is followed by death and hell. The rider in heaven is followed by the armies of heaven. Satan desires to be as God. He certainly is not God. Look at this and we'll close. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground which did weaken the nations? By the way, you're going to see this in the tribulation. For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mountain of congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. The devil is led by pride. He wants to bear rule. He thinks he's capable and worthy. He reminds me of the song of the Executive Car Wash Blues. You got this individual that has no skills, no abilities, but he thinks he should be ruling everything and running everything. You know what we call it in America? We call it the entitlement mentality. You know, we got a lot of young people today that don't have a clue about life and understand about hard labor, preparation, training, skill, sacrifice to gain godly. They think the world and society owes them a living. Nobody paid for my education, I paid for it myself. Nobody paid for my health care, I paid for it myself. I paid for it by getting a job that made a sacrifice of the time of my life to labor for the benefit of my employer so that he could make wealth for himself while I was making wealth for myself and my family. That's the way God's ordained it to work. That's the way capitalism works. This thing about stealing from me, I'm going to make it personal, to pay the bills of the lazy is as wicked as hell. You're a thief. A thief. You want to steal somebody else's money, Bernie Sanders, Barack Obama, and most of the Democratic Party. You want to steal somebody else's money to give it to somebody that won't work so you'll get them to vote for you so you can steal the votes so you can be in power and rule things when you're wicked. And God's coming to take you guys out. Get a job. Be honest for a change. Have a nice day. God bless. Your day's coming.